second session of this afternoon. The title of the next panel is The Know When You Underground and Digital Folklore Music Subcultures. And the panelists are Francesca, Mariano, Lucy March, and Miloš Hroch. And this panel is going to be moderated by Luigi Monteanni, who is here on my right-hand side. And I just wanted to introduce him. So Luigi is a PhD candidate in music studies at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London. And he has a very interesting PhD research thesis, or like what he's exactly approaching now, on the indigenization of extreme metal in Indonesia. And actually, I would love to hear a little bit more about that, but that's not the reason why we are here, unfortunately, today. There's many other reasons why we invited Luigi for this moderation today. For example, because he's also the co-founder of the Arte Tetra Records and also the duo Babao, and both projects are actually totally influenced by digital folklore, and I guess he will also talk about it later on. And there's another reason why we also invited today Luigi, because together with Matteo Penesi, he wrote a fantastic piece, and I would really recommend to all of you to read it. It's an article in Disco Journal, Sounds from the Modern Peripheries, a Survey of the Transglobal Digital Underground. And I love this article, and I guess also your talk on digital underground will be also based on that. So Luigi, the stage is yours, and yeah, welcome.
Hello, thank you very much, Anita, and without further ado, let's get to my PowerPoint presentation, which is called The Portal Under the Screen, and I will introduce the discussion with a sum of the article and a seminar I gave in 2022 about the relevance of digital subcultures in the contemporary musical ecosystem. So I will start by saying that it's banal to assert that the underground has been declared dead in the digital age. This is due to the critics of authors and writers such as David Keenan, Mark Fisher, and Simon Reynolds, who asserted that the post-1968 cultural expansion of bands like the Velvet Underground and Capitan Beefheart, the classic underground, is no longer a symbol of countercultural isolationism anymore. A matter of attitude had become a matter of genre and style to be emulated and eventually replicated. What's more, the web seems to have extinguished the idea of a true underground to dig for, as it is now too easy for everyone to find anything. But in Simon Reynolds' words, what does it actually mean anymore? It's very different from the late 60s and early 70s, when people talked to the underground and you could track a sort of equivalence or parallelism between the music and an organization. But all these online microgenres still seem themselves underground in some sense. Well, such line of thought is already reinforced by the idea of, taking into account two of the most popular internet music genres, arguably, to date, namely Vaporwave and/or Dungeon Synth. And this thought can be further developed by taking into account the famous iceberg memes, where genres from the most mainstream to the most obscure are placed respectively from the top to the bottom of the ice pyramid, which expands on the sensation that there are tons of new underground microgenres and pseudo-movements lurking from the online netherworlds, actually. So at this point, I'd like to take into account the opinion of Goldsmith scholar Stephen Graham, who, regarding a possible post-internet underground, has written, "The guerrilla nature of the underground, then, persists in the digital context. Gavin Pryor's wonderful coinage, To Hell or To Internet, sums up the situation for underground musicians from smaller musical centers, with the many and varied promotional and communicative possibilities of the internet proving a decisive recent factor in the nurturing of small underground scenes, opening up a crucial space for experimentation and for critiquing the mainstream." So, I really support Graham's position in considering that the underground is still alive on the internet, actually. Subgenres of this kind respect the pillars of the metagenre as it was studied, namely, they are under-the-radar projects pursuing aesthetic radicalism and a do-it-yourself ethos, intentionally placing themselves at the margins of the music industry. What has changed, in my opinion, is that the image of the underground is no more the one of sweaty bodies in a dim-lit cellar, but of noises coming from the bedrooms of our modern peripheries. So if I had to assert what I simply term the digital underground, is actually three broad elements. The first, the reliance on digital folklore,
So hybrid and synthetic repertoires of folk imageries and mythologies, from literal orc goblins and castles to non-existent beings and very abstract sci-fi concepts. The use, the exploitation of technopastiches, so a musical toolbox of mass-distributed consumer technologies and vernacular practices, smartphones, hats, act and cracked platforms. And these technopastiches work as a bridge, like an instrumental bridge that connects the imaginary of this kind of digital underground to what I term it's being a no-ground underground, a transnational network of musicians with scant to non-existent physical spaces, nor canon, actually. So, starting from these last concepts, I really think that the no ground underground, in a way, comes from two genealogical ideas. The first one is the concept of no audience underground by Robert Taylor of Radio Free Minwich, which is a movement in which the authors and fandom collide. The only fans are the ones that are making this kind of music. The other concept was pioneered by media anthropologist Gabriele De Seta, and is the one of the no venue underground. So the general preference of many underground musicians to favor new media technologies and spaces is actually instigated by a hostile cultural and urban policy making it increasingly difficult for artists to access spaces in real life. The dramatic and ongoing rise of rents in city centers, the continuous decline on independent clubs and live venues, and the criminalization of many autonomous zones and squats being a clear example of this tendency, actually. So what happened is that the actual digital underground has remodulated the pillars of the underground, kind of rethinking what it means to have an attitude these days, more than being a style or something. The audience underground also becomes a no-venue underground, confronts the loss of spaces with new platforms, reinterprets the aesthetic radicalism into a digital one, and arguably loses its canon as this digital underground becomes a blanket team that brings together more or less canonized subgenres, microgenres, but really thinks of an attitude that these people are pursuing, whether they want it or not. So basically, they become a physical community, and resorting to the tool of this imagined transnational one loses its canon and boundaries, becoming again a matter of attitude towards music production and circulation. The second idea is the one of digital folklore, also pioneered by Gabriele De Seta and defined as a vernacular emerging from below and a folk art created by users for users, coalescing into repertoires of jokes, memes, and other genres of digital content. Projects customarily resort to vernacular pirate techniques, such as sampling internet content or employing free or illegally downloaded music apps and softwares to propose readings of folklore through digital means, superimposing mythical registers and historical symbologies with the secularity and pop appeals of technological devices, memes, and video games. Why not? So more in general, I think that the three broad ways in which we can assert the presence and existence, ontology, if you will, of this digital underground, is that these participants employ digital media to express themselves through the digital folklore vernacular, create gateways to personal DIY world-building processes, and explore naive and light-hearted pastiches of audiovisual references and influences, of course, informally. For them, therefore, internet, their devices, it's a portal, a gateway, a doorway, a threshold, but also an escape route. As optimistically as I would like to think, I know that simultaneously, musicians involved in such a pseudo-subculture deal with issues and topics concerning the in-betweenness of imagination and creativity, but also the reactionary power of nostalgia and escapism, sometimes at least. But to make everything more concrete or more abstract, if you will, I think we should listen to a song in a while. It's a song from an album that we released on Arte Tetra. It's Mondo Riviera's Are You Leaving from a video game, is the soundtrack to a video game named Not Longa. And the album, I think it's a very good collision between the online underground music practices and digital folklore, as the soundtrack is described as the music to an abandoned retro game haunted by folk horror creatures and ghosts of broken futures. The video game is actually an 8-bit horror adventure that is based in Ravenna, a very not online thing that we have in Italy. It's a very famous city. Thereby, it configures a space where the digital is employed to execute a regional narrative, creating a suspended new liminal dimension, which is really what I like to explore today with my guests. So maybe you could listen to the excerpt of Mondo Riviera. Fantastic. After this very brief excerpt, as we have seen, discussion of different forms of digital underground is inseparable from commentaries related to topics of imagination, escapism, nostalgia, creativity, but also, on the other hand, with questions concerning digital tools, infrastructures, and the class issues they entail. What do these people do when they are inside their bedroom? How are their bedroom made? In which cities do they live? What do they do to participate in this community? So, therefore, I want to welcome my guests for today's panel. Please come to the stage. I will briefly introduce them where they find their way. The first one is Francesca Mariano. Is an artist whose research develops through performance and education with a cross-dimensional approach encompassing electronic music, fantasia, hydrofeminism, somatics, mythology, and speculative archaeology. Her last album, Euribia, has been released in 2022 on Living Records. Welcome, Francesca. I want to introduce Miloš Hroch, sorry for the pronunciation, Prague-based music journalist and contributor to The Wire magazine, The Creatus, and Alarm. He's a researcher and lecturer at the Department of Media Studies at the Faculty of Social Sciences, and also the author of the book Shout, That's Me, Stories of the Czech Fanzine from the 1980s to the Present, and translating from the Czech, as I don't know Czech, All Cats Are Grey, Music of Anxiety, co-authored with Karel Vasegi. The last guest that I want to welcome is Lucy March, that should be online. Hi, Lucy. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Fantastic. Welcome, Lucy. Lucy March is a doctoral student of media and communication at Temple University in Philadelphia, whose research is concerned with digital transcultural flows of popular music and characteristic of music genres that have primarily emerged online, also known as internet music, aptly described. So welcome, everybody. Thanks for being here, half in real life, half online, just to prove my point, in a way. And actually, I really want to start with a broad question of all the things that we have seen, which is, how does your experience of this still developing broad and arguably opaque musical field applies to these themes, the ones of the imagination and the ones related to tools and infrastructure? I would like to start with Francesca, especially because she was part of the article I wrote for the journal, as I think she represents a very peculiar example of participation in the digital underground.
Thank you. I think in my musical practice, dealing with the imagination and trying to answer your question for today made me think about what is the imagination and how from the human imagination, which is one of our greatest capacities to create and to transform our world, we could say, for the better in the arts. It led me to think about how in my music I wanted to reflect on the differences and similarities between fantasy themes and sci-fi and how they are similar and how they differ. And so related to fantasy, I mean, in both of them, we have a sort of, we are in the realm of speculative fiction. And But while fantasy deals with something quite impossible to realize in our reality, science fiction is more related to how our unadvanced enough technology could take new realities, while fantasy deals with a much more escapist themes in a way, because it deals with the themes of magic, of mythical creatures and monsters, and all of things that are related to sometimes the folklore, in the sense that a lot of the images that may come up in a fantasy related, whether it be a musical album or a novel, can take a lot from the folklore existing in our cultures. And so how these ideas exist in our imagination, and how how the music made from computers these days have, I noticed both in my practice and in the practice of people around me, that there is like an inspiration to maybe start, as you said, in an escapist way into the natural world, although we know there is like a blurry lines between what's natural and what's not. And taking, so the anthropomorphization in a way of who could inhabit certain natural landscapes. So it could be like fairies in the forest and mermaids in the ocean and all of these creatures that may have an inspirational force into our imagination. So I think the line between creativity and escapism is always very thin, but I like to explore that and to let it guide through whatever it takes into the music.
Fanta, I really like this kind of distinction that you make between imagination and fantasy, which I think also draws to the fact that it's, you know, very subjective and blurry, and makes us consider what it really means to imagine things for real. I think that it's interesting that Benjamin Noyes has kind of rewritten this idea of imagination, saying that sometimes metal is deemed to be reactionary because it draws from a certain type of imagination, whereas techno is believed to be progressive because it arises from the other pole in a way. But he also said that in a way, techno develops a nostalgia for an imagined possible future. So it really flips the point of view that we have. Thank you, Francesca. I would like to know from Lucy, that is following online, if she has comments to do on this broad idea of how imagination intersects with the digital world. I know she has something to say.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, so in my own work, I sort of tend to follow a more critical theory line of thinking. And I think the stereotype that's often true is critical theorists tend to be looking for problems with something, right? With a cultural text or scene that they're interested in. And in my own work, I tend to be most interested in how certain genres of internet music, you know, like you mentioned in your own presentation, Vaporwave, Luigi, as well as, you know, various other similar genres and scenes, can, through this idea of imagination and play with certain, you know, ideas about culture, ideas about identity, how, you know, certain problematic representations or ideas about those cultures might be reinforced. And, you know, this is sort of a gap that I've noticed in both, you know, academic research and, you know, observations by cultural critics or even by participants in those own, in participants of those scenes. There tends to be sort of a lack of reckoning with how, you know, by using our imagination, by sort of maybe occupying different identities or playing with imagery from different cultures, we could perhaps be reinforcing certain stereotypes or maybe even flattening certain identity markers associated with certain cultures. So racial identity, gender identity, national identity, those are the issues that I tend to focus on, yeah, in terms of how imagination is used in these scenes. And of course, there's, you know, incredible potentials in those scenes as well. You know, again, sort of focusing on how this could also lead to certain reinforcement of maybe more negative characteristics, and sort of following the call to action by Andre Brock, who is an American scholar of internet culture, and he coined his own methodological approach to looking at internet culture called critical technocultural discourse analysis. And I've been really inspired by his call to sort of look at how, in a lot of ways, the internet can reinforce whiteness as a dominant identity marker, sort of the default identity marker of individuals who use the internet. And I think in some ways, the scenes that I'm concerned with can reinforce that. So, you know, again, while there are a lot of incredible potentials for producers to use their imagination to explore different geographies or different temporalities and sort of mixing those things in a way that wouldn't be possible offline, I am particularly interested in how that can also perpetuate certain harmful stereotypes, like, for example, the use of sort of techno-orientalist imagery in the vaporwave scene. So that's what I've looked at in terms of, you know, imagination and nostalgia, you know, as we know from, you know, Benjamin Noy's work that you mentioned, Luigi, and Georgina Bourne as well. We know that nostalgia doesn't always, you know, necessarily have to be a positive thing. It can be complex. It can be very negative. It can be even toxic oftentimes. So that's sort of the perspective that I've taken thus far in my work.
Could you maybe, before passing the word to Miloš, elaborate a little more on these examples, because I read your articles, of course, and I know about your work and the analysis of the actual case studies, if you want to call it that way. It's apt for this discussion.
Absolutely. So in terms of what I've looked at in depth, of course, with my I've entered the proposal prospectus phase of my dissertation. I hope to look a little bit more in depth at these scenes and also, you know, engage with both producers and participants to sort of, you know, ask them about what choices they make that sort of make up the characteristics of these scenes. But I have in the past looked at, like I mentioned, vaporwave. I've looked at how the paratextual characteristics of the vaporwave scene in particular, so track titles, album artwork, even the sort of imagery that certain producers use to identify themselves. As we know, the vaporwave scene is often completely anonymous on the part of both producers and fans. And producers will often inhabit multiple sort of anonymous identities. And so that can often be used to not only maybe uncritically use imagery from East Asian culture, but also to even take on the identity of someone who is East Asian or might be living in East Asia. And, you know, that often isn't actually the case. But, you know, again, because it is so difficult to determine, you know, where these producers might be located geographically, it's very difficult to examine the sort of power dynamics at play in these interactions. So we can't necessarily point at something and just say, well, that's bad, you shouldn't be doing that. It tends to get a little bit more complicated, but what I try to focus on is, you know, what ideas about East Asia, what ideas about Japan in particular, is this imagery reinforcing? Is it sort of reinforcing this idea that was very popular in the United States and the West more broadly in the 1980s, this Japan panic as the country was economically rising to power. So, you know, since vaporwave plays on a lot of these themes of 1980s consumer culture, it can often sort of, you know, in a tongue-in-cheek way, reinforce some of these ideas that were prominent about Japan at that time. This isn't something I've looked at in depth, but another scene that I'm particularly interested in is the funk scene, pronounced funk, but spelled P-H-O-N-K, which is a digital revival of the 1990s Memphis trap scene. And a lot of producers in that scene are white, and they're playing with a lot of imagery from sort of the original scene that led to this revival. So to me, that brings up a lot of questions about, like, who has the right or who has the ability to revive a scene and sort of gain recognition from sort of the way that they're creatively reworking a lot of this music, especially when the original artists may have not gotten any sort of material recognition at that time. So that's what I'm particularly interested in specifically.
Fantastic. I like how this idea of an opaqueness of people interacting, being prosumers online, basically participating in this community, kind of refrain us from understanding what is really going on, which I think is a big part of this imagination land that is the internet in a way. And I also like this idea of ventriloquism for who doesn't know. So like trying to use the mask of some elements of Black culture, Asian cultures, and defending themselves with a new kind of invisible shroud that is the net. So thank you, Lucy. And I want to pass now the word to Miloš to know what he has to say.
Yeah, thanks. There's a lot of things to unpack, I guess, what has already been said. What I can say now, I observe, like, which is like important and powerful, is people combining imagination of ancient and modern, and it has already been said. And yeah, there's the problem with nostalgia, which I can remember what Simon Reynolds once said, that retromania in music can be probably only boring, like 60s revival in guitars, but if it's retromania connected with politics, it can be very dangerous. In the title of this talk, there's this digital folklore thing, and I think that also there are a lot of people who are dealing somehow with the folklore and yeah, fairy tales and you know, folk tales and so on, but not only to unchain their imagination, but also like to sort of instill the sense of place into their music, so they are trying to relate to something which is local, and it says something about their place, but not in a reactionary way. They are trying to re-signify or reinterpret folklore in more, for instance, queer or like more open way, and that's what I think it's powerful nowadays.
Do you think that you have special examples of these kind of tendencies as opposed to other, you know, more classic reactionary rereadings of fantasy? Do you think that they can also come from the same, genre? Metal would be an example, but I think there are many more, I guess.
If I'm talking about this like sort of reimagination of folklore, I'm thinking about a lot of musicians and labels and collectives coming from Central and Eastern Europe. For instance, we can mention Polish label Tance or Slovakian producer Nina Pixel, who has this ongoing project Ancestral Archaeology, and she is trying, like, she's digging into like Slovakian occulture and also into some sort of like folklore dances and so on, and she's trying to reinterpret it in more open way, which fits her identity. So I think it's a really good example.
I really like the fact that in a way it seems to me, at least, that your example divides on how you use imagination, of course, because what I personally never kind of liked is to see imagination as an escapist fantasy. You're talking about folklore, mythologies, origins of some sorts. You must be trying to rewrite something reactionarily, at least. I don't think that Francesca is doing any of this, so I really want to repass the words to her to talk a bit more about her experience of positive cases of imagination, mythologies, re-symbolizing of these things. Maybe naivete and do it yourself?
I was trying to connect this point, beautiful thing that you were saying about how the naive approach sometimes is originated from the fact that some of us, I speak for myself, are non-trained classically musicians, so you approach the computer in a way that is necessarily has a naive touch, because not being an expert of the field, you sort of trying to understand how to move through it and how to pass your idea in like an instinctual way through the computer medium until something comes to start to take the form. And from this point, I like to talk about, for instance, the idea of like how playfulness sometimes is dismissed as something childish or less serious from like electronic music, you know, I'm a musician.
Seriousness, seriousness, you would say.
But retracing the kind of like tradition of what I define in my own imagination as playful music with artists such as Raymond Scott or Ursula Bogner, for instance, what I really take from this playfulness, especially in their approach, is like a sort of brain massage that this type of music can do to tickle your imagination and take you to places as if the screen becomes a sort of a portal again into being able to perceive, for instance, shapes, geometry, and just matter and sound as a playful universe in a way. So in this matter, I would like to show one of the videos that I...
Absolutely.
It doesn't have to deal necessarily with the artist I just mentioned, but a little bit of the playfulness and perhaps the problematic, nostalgic ideas.
Are you talking about Free Willy?
The Free Willy soundtrack.
Let's play Free Willy then, believe it or not.
The first minute. From the beginning.
Can we?
From the beginning.
Could we replay it from the beginning, actually?
From the zero.
I find it a fantastic tune, actually.
It's beautiful.
Do you want to talk a bit about it?
Yeah, just a few words about when we're speaking about fantasy genre or the encounter of fantasy and sci-fi genres in computer music. There is a lot of the times, since you're building a world in your mind, they are shaped as soundtracks. So there is, for sure, a sort of parallelism with the film soundtracks, for instance, or they could be soundtracks for films or video games or cartoons and things like this. And in this particular case, I go back to the feeling and the meme that you showed of haters be mad, I can experience childlike wonder. Because this the sort of hero's journey that the protagonist goes through in his friendship with the animal sort of, in a way, makes his loneliness as an adolescent teenager more easy to affrontare, to face, because
to
of the friendship that he builds with this animal and the quest for freedom that they have together. And in a way, there is something about that adventurous feeling that you have as a child. Like, I don't know, that is very inspiring for me personally.
Absolutely. No, this reminds me of a wonderful book that I suggest to everybody, which is called The Game Black Girls Play, and it is written by Kyra Gaunt, and she tells how basically the little girls jumping the rope and their vocal gains were kind of exploited by the music industry. It's a very long story, I'm sorry, can't tell it. But like, were exploited by the music industry to kind of frame the sound of hip hop. And I find that like the use of fantasy that you mentioned, this naive kind of, you know, without pretense way of dealing with the daily hardships of life for children, is kind of remodeled and being exploited or kind of facing its coming of age in its darkest depths, and this is also the case from the internet, which kind of leads us to something that is always less discussed, in my opinion, which are the problems of class, of urbanism that might be entailed. In my framing of the online underground, which is not a genre but is a blanket for how people produce and circulate music, I try to ask myself, why do people resort to the internet? Isn't it because we don't have the tools, the instruments to go offline? Sometimes we can, but sometimes not. Why do we rely on a transnational community, for example? How does this intersect with their imaginative practice? Miloš, maybe?
I guess we tend to talk about the things which happen in digital underground only in terms of you know, zeros and ones, but it has also material reality, like algorithms are also like discursive material assemblages. And I guess there's one thing, a few things to mention that, underground, the notion of underground is changing right now. Also, the notion of mainstream is changing, you know, it's similarly decentralized as the underground, you know, so.
Absolutely.
And also the notion, the internet has changed, you know.
Enrico Monacelli has argued actually that today is not difficult to say what is underground, but it's very difficult to say what is mainstream.
Because the whole environment led us to choose whatever music, video games, social media platforms we want to, you know, circle our lives around, and it can be different, you know. There's lack of consensus, I guess. And I got carried away a bit, I just wanted to say that also the internet, like Hito Steyrl says that internet has lost its possibility, you know, because it became into what some critics call a corporate platform complex, you know, so the space on the internet is much more private, commercialized, sorry for the pronunciation.
No worries, but so you agree? And it's a question that I will ask everybody. Do you agree that, to a certain extent, there is nothing outside the mainstream, as Mark Fisher would have said? Like, it's impossible to claim that you're underground. If you're claiming that you're underground is to stress your diversity from inside the system, then?
I believe that underground exists still, that digital underground exists, but it's you know, they are it exists in dark internet and the deep SoundCloud, you know. It's to be underground in the environment of so-called corporate platform complex means to escape the algorithm, escape the, you know, streaming services in a way. And I guess a good example is Seniava, Indonesian avant-garde metal duo, who are trying to develop their own infrastructure, their own app, streaming apps, and so on and so on.
Fantastic. I wanted to ask you very like unorthodox but direct question. How your audiovisual example that you brought that we did not show yet would intersect with this? So maybe we can show it and then.
Oh yeah. My example is Keith Rankin's, aka Giant Claw's, performance at Unsound, and it in my opinion very much like define what No Venue Underground is, because it was performed during the pandemics and there were no venues were shut down.
Could we play the video? Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miloš. I really like this performance, to be honest.
And also it loosely connects to Lucy's topic because Keith Rankin is someone who comes out of the first vaporwave scene and yeah, he's co-founder of Orange Milk Records.
Absolutely. Thank you for anticipating me. I was going to say how vaporwave, which is a very canonized genre, Lucy knows, kind of shifted his approach. And I think that Orange Milk was one of the first things I was thinking about when dealing with this idea of digital underground. The Modem radio show from Ljubljana is a great example, showcasing a quantity of music from the internet, like internet music. So maybe, Lucy, you can talk a bit about these issues of how digital tools, class issues, and the infrastructures intersect with our being or being fake participants of the underground, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can think of sort of a lot of threads from this conversation that can sort of problematize this. Yeah, this idea of the no venue underground, even this term internet music, that's the reason why I sort of find it so fascinating is what does that word even mean? Sort of, I mean, the idea of the internet in internet music, it can point to a lot of different ways that the internet functions as sort of not only a structure for these musics, but sort of an inspiration for them in a lot of ways. So, you know, aside from vaporwave, I was also thinking a lot about when Miloš and Francesca were talking about hyperpop, and to sort of temper my own negativity from earlier, I do think, you know, a lot of these scenes do hold a lot of potential for, you know, more subversive sort of identity and representation, the ability to sort of engage with that. I think hyperpop is an excellent example, but at the same time, you know, a lot of people might say, oh, well, with 100 Gex, hyperpop went mainstream. It's no longer an internet genre, like, you know, sort of with, they would assign it the same fate as vaporwave, right? Like it died as soon as it went mainstream. And, you know, I would sort of like to challenge that a little bit. And I would still consider, even though, you know, hyperpop and even now vaporwave are both decidedly genres and scenes with a very solid in-person presence. For example, here on the East Coast, we have the, I don't know if it's the only vaporwave festival. I certainly think that it's the largest Electronicon, which happens in New York City every summer, or it was on hiatus until this past year for a couple of years. But I attend, you know, vaporwave live shows all the time. And, you know, they have pretty pricey merch when you go there, which I'm willing to fork out $40 for a shirt, absolutely. But you know, these have become decidedly in-person genres. So what role at that point does the internet play in this, or the venue play in this idea of an internet genre or a no venue underground genre? And I think it plays sort of increasingly more of a cultural role. So again, back to this idea of the imagination, we're sort of reflecting on the experience of what it feels like to be online, what it felt like to be online at a certain point in time. I think it obviously still serves as an extremely important infrastructure. I think particularly the platforms that a lot of these genres still coalesce around, the way that those platforms function or, you know, aesthetically are sort of presented to the user influences a lot of ways in which the genre has sort of functions or presents itself. But I also think it's become more of an abstract idea too. So the internet sort of serves as like the muse for, I think, a lot of these producers. That would be my opinion.
Okay, fantastic. No, I perfectly agree. And that was one of my questions, not only like how the internet works as a tool for musicians, but how the internet becomes the main field in which musicians start to craft their idea and like build their imaginations. I think that many of the way references are pierced up in some of the project, less canonized project I was analyzing, come from this very hyperlink-like superimposition of different literal pages, I guess, on the net. I guess that we are going towards the end, so I wanted to ask a last question before maybe opening up to the public, which is, we have seen, I don't know if you knew, but if you don't know, I'll tell you, the word for Merriam-Webster, I think, of 2022 was goblin mode, so like being at home during the pandemic, not washing, living like a goblin, eating, blah, blah, blah. But I really found fascinating how from the underground, in a way, from the resurgence or literal appearance of dungeon scene, for example, to the reincantation of certain rave artists, or like conceived as a rave-inspired artist nowadays, we're going towards an imagination that before was quite abstract, you know, very undefined sci-fi concepts, to slowly kind of literal medieval folklore beings, you know, like literal. The image that I showcased from my presentation was from DJ David Goblin playing like very weird feats of what he calls orc muzak. I don't know, guys. But anyways, I want to start with Francesca and ask about everyone about this re-enchantment, what appears as a re-enchantment of our music, basically, of our music production.
I think I would like to pass the word and think about it for like a minute, because they're like mentioning all these subgenres.
Only difficult question, guys. I'm sorry.
I can speak more about my personal experience,
yeah.
But I'll pass for now and have
fantastic.
A thought.
Miloš, maybe?
Oh yeah, I will be speaking and thinking at the same time, I guess. But yeah, this you mentioned goblin mode, but before goblin mode there was goblin synth, like subgenre or hashtag. But from these hashtags, new micro genres are born. Actually, yeah, this re-enchantment. I think also that a lot of people are digging into, you know, medieval aesthetics and druids and fantasy and so on. It can be from several reasons. Maybe that the whole cycle of inspiration has exhausted itself. Yeah, or I can see it, this re-enchantment also, that some they want to imagine some place like adventures in Neverland or somewhere else, like, and it's a sort of form of resistance to the culture, which is algorithmically calculated, and you know, we talk about you know, algorithmization of taste and so on and so on. So that maybe that's form of how to escape this.
Okay, so like to counteract this, like,
yeah.
Technological.
Yeah, mathematics and magic, you know, like, maybe.
No, it's a very interesting binary. I'm sure that it works for a lot of things, so it might be one of the main reasons, as you say. Mm. I would like to ask Lucy then, because, like, coming from what we could term capitalist mythologies, if you want to use Bart, how do you see the fact that slowly this kind of internet imagination, it's from something like vaporwave that was very common, is kind of shifting, arguably.
Yeah, absolutely. Sort of what Milos was saying got me thinking a little bit about trends like the one that's sort of becoming more prominent now on TikTok is core. Mm.
Yeah.
Which once you're sort of taking the suffixes and just, yeah, it's the internet is over, right? And, you know, yeah, have we sort of reached the end of inspiration? I think, you know, some people might argue that, you know, Simon Reynolds argued that with Retromania, sort of we've reached the end of doing anything really new with popular music. Again, I might sort of push back against that. I think we are always reinventing our experience with capitalism, and, you know, sort of how it makes us feel based in a certain time period. I think there's a lot of potential still for creativity. But I do find it really interesting that maybe we've sort of reached the end in terms of what we can do with cores and waves. You know, we have things like weird core and internet core that are just, it's getting so meta. It's just, it's kind of hard to comprehend, But I absolutely think, you know, sort of our experience with the pandemic, with how it sort of altered our lives and our relationship to the internet, I do think we are still reckoning with that in a lot of ways creatively. And sort of, I think gobble note is maybe an idea that sort of came out of or was inspired by that. And I think it will sort of, the reverberations on society will continue to, I think, inspire producers and scene participants and result in sort of new capitalist mythologies or sort of new forms of folklore as, you know, the internet is constantly changing, our relationship with it is constantly changing. I think there's always something new and creative. And I definitely wouldn't argue that we've sort of reached a standstill, even though we have things like core, which is just, I think it's absolutely hilarious. And someone needs to,
over the
someone
top.
Needs to investigate that, absolutely.
I will do it if I have time, I promise.
Something came to my mind.
Please.
After hearing this very nice point. Yeah, about this goblin core that I wasn't completely aware of, but it made me think about the idea of alienation when composing or making music in your own bedroom or your own private and intimate sphere of your home, when not having access to a studio, for instance, and how in this sort of alienation that's brought from working on our computers on our own, mentioning my friend and colleague Seat Foray that I work with on some music and dance projects, and how she talks about a constructive form of alienation. So it's basically just the idea of reappropriating the alienation that we feel when we sort of like go into this solo escapist internet, very airy in a way, because it's like a place of distraction, and so many things that can happen while you're making music because you're at home. So I don't know, you gotta make the pasta or you gotta do things, and so this constructive form of alienation seems to be like a good key to see how to engage with the goblin.
To recuperate your goblin roots.
Yes,
your
goblin roots.
Fantastic. As promised to everybody, we ended up talking about goblins, but I really would like to open the discussion to the public if you have any type of questions. I mean, after goblins and orcs, it can get weirder than that, so anything goes, I guess. So while you think about it, I had kind of a conclusive question that was like very abstract, so you don't need to really think about it that much. But Gavin Pryor said, to hell or to internet. So like it's a fact for him as a class issue. But I want to ask this question as much as a Zen koan, to hell or to internet, if you had to choose? only difficult questions, I know. I promise that. If you want to know, I'll go with the internet.
I mean, it's so problematic.
This won't save you now, though. No idea? It seems that everyone, like, it's a funny comment, but it's a comment. I really think that what was interesting of this is that we, as I hoped in a way, we didn't reach a point in which we feel like condemning the internet, but also we really don't feel like promoting them as an infrastructure, promoting it as an infrastructure. I don't know, I want to interpret this kind of difficulty in answer, because if you ask me, I really go with internet as is the only infrastructure that is free, you know, whatever it means, although it's not outside of all the problems that we already know. But just what I noticed is that many young kids can experiment and literally play and be part of, you know, this musical game that we call this peripheral community.
For sure, it's more democratic also with all the remixing that has been happening on TikTok music, for instance, what happens there. But at the same time, it's very hard to answer because you know that there is such a marketing system of control around it that you can't really escape, so you try to subvert it and run around it, and sometimes you are so much part of it as well, and sometimes, yeah. Sorry.
No, continue.
I'm done.
I would say to hell, to internet, and probably also to the material reality, you know, because what, and I guess it also connects a bit to what Lucy has said, that vaporwave is having its own, like, festival and it's performed live. So what I see now, that former digital underground is going post-digital, and maybe it's sort of a consequence of the pandemics and what is events of past 2 years, but a lot of musicians formerly associated with the tech as like post-club music or deconstructed music are trying to play acoustic instruments, forming sort of bands and performing as bands and live, and so they are not using only internet tools but also like the sort of traditional instruments, without distinguishing what is old and what is new, and I guess it may describe this sort of post-digital situation.
So you think that anyway, like gaining a hold of physical space, whether like a physical instrument or a physical venue, if we want, it's a part of this reconstruction of the underground, or is like outside?
I guess it's certainly true for one generation of these musicians, you know, like for, I don't know, Rabbit, if we mention, yeah.
Fantastic. Lucy, do you have anything to add, anything that came to your mind?
To your question, I would respond, hell is other people, right? And, you know, as much as we sort of try to hide or anonymize ourselves behind these, you know, playing hide and go seek within these scenes, you know, behind the avatars, you know, there are people, right? And as much as these platforms will sort of try to control our behavior, guide us towards certain behaviors using algorithmic recommendations, at the end of the day, these scenes, these genres are made up of, you know, people, prosumers, like you said, Luigi, you know, sort of the no audience underground, right? So, you know, our actions in these spaces matter, right? And, you know, so in that way, I would say hell or the internet, it's a little bit of both, right?
Fantastic. In the meantime, if you, yes, one question.
Also probably the meme scene on the internet. And do you have an idea how you see this evolving, or what are the consequences of it, or are there existing like counter movements against that? Or, and yeah, I'm wondering, because I'm thinking a lot about this kind of topics myself, and I always wonder what how it will be in 5 or 10 years. So that's what I wanted to ask.
Anyone has an idea, wants to start? I'll start by saying something very brief. Well, maybe you think about it, I'll improvise. I think that in a way, the structure of memes follows a lot the one of extreme metal and metal in general. So memes have been heavily politicized in the last year. Everybody knows how they have served the right wing or now, like in a way, the progressive left wing kind of programs and ideas, but also when you refer, that is my opinion, of course, my experience of memes, when you refer to the communities that make these memes and that kind of are not necessarily into the political use, like aware use of the internet in that way, they try to refuse the political use of their means. This doesn't mean that they're not doing politics, like metalheads. Darktron were an example in the past of how they used the racial slurs, basically, and then they tried to stress that it was, you know, like, it's not matter, it's not used for racial purposes, you know. So I think that my experience is that they are following pretty much the same trail. They don't want to think about this awareness, like, they refuse awareness on their means, and they refuse most of the times, whether it's memes or online communities in general. In Lucy, I think this is very clear, you know, like how Vaporwave is saying, I mean, it's just music, it's just my funny perception of Asian culture and capitalism. It's refusing this awareness and then still doing these things that kind of define its spirits, I guess, and brings together the two things. There is agreement, so I think I have exhausted the thing. Other comments, questions? Anita?
Not me. We have an online question.
We are not, sorry.
Actually, from your friend, Matteo Panessi.
Hi,
online,
Matteo.
And
always online.
So I'm going to read out what he's asking. I feel that the need to find a strong mood as aesthetics is pushed by the need to share visual works through social media. So don't you think that musicians right now have a strong approach on visual more than in the past? So
this is a very nice question and something he knows I'm very concerned about, Quinn. So I won't talk, I will leave it to you. Stronger visual approach?
Yeah, definitely. There is like in other creative practices, like endless scrolling of Pinterest to arrive to the perfect expression of what I was looking for in the sound, and also a lot of musicians that work with computer are also amazing graphic artists, and they sort of work with both the mediums. So I personally think it can be a great thing, but maybe as long as it doesn't become too much of an aesthetic rather than something that also has a depth to it.
So just like paratextual information.
Yeah.
Lucy, Miloš.
Lucy. Best to Lucy. If.
No, I would agree. I was absolutely eager to hear because I have tended to be, and I hope to sort of expand my work a little more to engage more with producers and hear about their experiences. Just from what I've observed, I would say that, yeah, absolutely, visuality is in a lot of ways perhaps even taking precedent over sound in terms of how you know, artists and scenes present themselves. But yeah, I was very interested to hear the producer perspective, and maybe is there additional pressure that wasn't there before, particularly when presenting yourself as an artist across multiple platforms.
And yeah, I would agree as well. And there was this term in your presentation, world building. So I guess musicians and producers are have tendency to create more immersive environments with their music, and yeah, also take inspiration from video games and so on. I guess it captures the term by yeah again Simon Reynolds, conceptronica. Like yeah. It may relate to the topic.
Yeah, I also think maybe just to add something to what you said. I think that it's also because we are becoming more and more a multimedia culture in general. So like I don't know, it's not something that I necessarily believe in, but I was thinking that maybe it's not that necessarily musicians have a stronger visual approach, but that everything, every one of us, in a way, wants to progressively consume things that are multimedia. I was watching a YouTube video about how, for many of the people, according to a survey, young people, arguably, video games are now what music was for generations, for a couple generations ago. So like communal meeting now happens online with multimedia products that are music, that are images, that are like interactive. So
Yeah, and yeah, that's also the question of the infrastructure, that the internet is also like pushing artists to engage in these ways. I would say like there's this term cognitive capitalism, like to extract attention economy and so on. So it may relate to.
And I also think that the visual aspect of an album or a musical project is one of the ways in which the social media platforms are exploited in their best way, because most of the times a musician meets a graphic artist or visual artist or painter thanks to the internet, and they start building together the imaginary, visual imaginary of the music project. So there is definitely this like visual impact that you're like, oh yeah, I want to work with them.
Yeah.
Like I really think that they could bring this idea to the visual aspect of it.
I really agree that in a way, like these communities also bring together different people that are interested in the same things, maybe, but they come from different fields of the arts. Maybe someone does visual arts, someone does music, but still they kind of meet in the middle with some, you know, abstract interest towards the aesthetic possibilities they have. I think we're done. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you had fun. Thanks CTM for hosting this talk. Thanks to my guests, Miloš, Francesca, and Lucy. See you around.